I like your approach here of taking what I call a 10,000 foot over the runway look at how we got here.
Yes.
And how, in fact, couples who ought to have been better models for marriage flopped in that modeling. And the more marriage, as it's been defined for the past three or four millennia, as that has weakened, then the definition itself has weakened. Is that a fair summary of where you're going?
Well, I think that's right. I think that throughout my entire lifetime, mm-hmm. the sexual revolution has been in full swing, you know. And what that, the one of the great premises of the sexual revolution is that, and was that, you can separate sex from procreation, and you can separate both from marriage. And that
right.
this is a good thing, to, you know, to separate sex, marriage, and babies. And that's, you know, sounded like a lot of fun in 1965 when we all thought we were going to be able to have sex without babies. Now we're to the point where we're having babies without having sex, which I'm pretty sure is not as much fun most of the time.
For the lab technicians.
Yeah, not, right. You know, it's just not the same deal. Yeah. But the point is that unity that marriage provided, that integrity that marriage provided, and the protection that it provided for the interests of children, that has broken down on multiple fronts there because yeah. sex, procreation, and marriage are separated from one another. And so I would like to say, you know, before we even start talking about the question you guys have been talking about for the last hour, you know, that we have to just take a sober-minded look at this situation and realize that marriage has already been attacked and that people who believe in redefining marriage, I was listening to them as I drove in, you've already got to believe a few things. I mean, first of all, there's three things I think you have to already believe. First of all, you have to believe that marriage is principally about adults and their feelings. And not right. at all, or very minimally, about children and their needs.
And about sex.
Yeah, well...
Our side are continually repeating, you have to include sexual union between man and woman. That's what marriage is. The other side, that are all about sexual license and so on, never bring it up. Well, they go back to the intense emotional bond model.
Right, and they can throw out, sex is not integral to the mm-hmm. thing, you know,
right.
if you come right down to it. So that's right, what you just said is right. But the point of marriage... from the modern point of view, is that it's about adults and how they feel. It's not about children and what they need. It's not about creating a vehicle that will allow children to be connected with both of their parents. And there's no right. sense that children have legitimate entitlements, you know, and I think mm-hmm. children are entitled to a relationship with both of their parents. And if you're going to deny a child that, you better have a good reason. And the idea that I just don't feel like it, or I don't want to have a relationship with my child's other parent, that's not really a good enough reason. But we've already accepted that through no-fault divorce and so on. So that's one big thing. The other big thing is we've accepted the idea that men and women are completely interchangeable for all practical
right.
purposes. And so, therefore, you can change out parents and have two dads or two moms, and it doesn't, you know, who cares? You know, that's not
right.
significant. And then finally, we've, as a culture, accepted the idea that sex is and ought to be a sterile activity, and that babies come along only when you choose them, kind mm-hmm. of as an afterthought if you happen to have quirky lifestyle preferences. Yeah, then you can have a baby. But basically, sex is supposed to be a sterile activity. And you have to sterilize the sexual act in order to believe that it's completely private. Right, because otherwise these little babies keep popping up.
Yeah, unless it's a homosexual sex act, in which case it's the sterilization is built in.
It's intrinsically sterile. Mm-hmm. That is correct. And that's why I think so many people that you wouldn't ordinarily necessarily expect being allies have rallied around the cause of genderless marriage. You know, you wouldn't think that, you know, abortion and homosexual practice have that much to do with each other. You wouldn't think gay men would care about abortion. You wouldn't think abortion providers would be marketing to gay men, you know. So as a business
right.
model, you say that's not what's going on. What's going on is that they have a common view of human sexuality mm-hmm. and what it means and how it ought to be. And they're all working together to create a world in which sex is a sterile activity and marriage is about adults and how they feel.
Right.
And that world, I would submit, is what's behind, that's kind of the premise, behind the redefinition of marriage. And what I'm concerned about is that by the courts declaring that this is the way we are to look at marriage, that marriage is intrinsically a genderless institution, and you may not say otherwise, you're enshrining into law things that are simply not true. And that will have long-term consequences.
As Colonel O'Connor said, the law is the great teacher. Hard to unring the bell.
Yeah, it's the great teacher and it's the great constrainer. You know, mm-hmm. it's channeling people towards certain things. You know, it's saying you can't do certain things and you must do other things. You know,
right?
And so it's a big deal to change definitions at the legal level like that.
We are going to take a pause after this lovely reset with our guest, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, the founder and president of the Ruth Institute. I love the subtitle. Go to ruthinstitute.org and you'll read lots of juicy wisdom, helping the victims of the sexual revolution. Love it. Works for me. Ruth.